Hi, everyone. Where's everyone coming from today? Cool. Florida, LA, Washington, Chicago. Amazing. New York, Georgia, Germany, Atlanta, Minnesota. That's awesome. Manchester. Wow. Cool. Well, let's get started. Hi, everyone. Thank you for coming to class. I'm so happy to be here, and thank you to Creatively for having me. I'm really excited to share my experience with you. I personally did not set up to be a creative director, but I ended up here, and I had to figure it all along the way. And it would have been helpful to have some tips along the way. So I will share what I've learned with you, and hopefully in doing so, you can skip some of those curves and kind of winding road to becoming a creative director. Can everybody see the presentation? Yes, awesome. Cool, so let's go to the next slide. I'll just tell you a little bit about myself before we get started. I'm Juliana Jaramillo. I'm a Colombian living in New York City. I'm currently an executive creative director at Jack Morton, which is a global brand experience agency. And I'm also an amateur ceramicist. I make these cups here in the middle. You know, each of them has a unique story. They all look different and they all come with their own adoption certificate. If you want to check them out, you can go to the Instagram. It's JJ Objects. I'm also an urban farmer. That's me on the right. But truly I'm more of a picker, as my partner is the one that he does all the work. And so I'm sharing this stuff, you know, at first glance, it might seem a little bit random, this random biography, but I believe that my Latin American background, all my different interests and kind of my inherent curiosity have helped me get this wider view of the world and are part of who I am as a creative director. And so that's why I wanted to share that with you. But enough about me, we can go through what we're going to cover today. So we're going to be starting with creative directors. What are they? Who are they? What are the different types that are out there? Then we're going to review a little bit about what's the path to becoming one, right? Like, what's that traditional path? But then I also pulled out some real life examples from people that I've worked with, just to kind of like get a sense of what the different varieties are. And I'm also going to talk a little bit about my personal path. And then thirdly, we're going to talk about a little bit about the skills and qualities that, in my opinion, make a good CD. I mean, there's a ton of things that good CDs can do, but I chose the three that I think are the most important. And then we'll leave some time at the end for some Q&A in case I missed anything or you have any other questions, so we can have a conversation then. Great. So let's go. Creative directors, what are they? So I pulled the dictionary definition here. So a creative director is a person in a company or advertising agency who's in charge of the work involving original ideas about how to design, advertise, and sell products. So, you know, when I look at this definition, it's an okay definition. You understand that essentially the creative director is that person leading the creative work, but it doesn't really illustrate what it's really like to be a creative director. And so what I'm hoping is that by the end of the hour, you'll have a better understanding of what that title or definition really means. And so I wanted to do a quick exercise and see, I did this myself when I was creating the presentation, but I wanted to get a sense of when I say creative director, what is the first name that comes to mind? For example, it could be George Lewis. And if you can type it into the chat, just so we can get a sense of what people are thinking. And again, it could be in any industry, it could be dead or alive, just the first name that pops into your head. Virgil Abloh, yep. Doug Sullivan, David LaChapelle, Vico, cool, yep. Awesome. Anthony Vaccarello. It's great. We can all, if there's some here that people haven't heard of, this is also great. You can go and do a deep dive and learn about all these different people. So when I did this, if we go to the next slide, these are the three people that came to mind just immediately. The first one, you know, Don Draper, and maybe it's because I'm currently watching Mad Men. But if you haven't watched the show, you know, he's a creative director in the show, Mad Men, and he's a protagonist, and, you know, he works at a fictional firm in Manhattan. His character is actually inspired by a real person, someone that, was a creative director in Chicago's Leo Burnett. His name is Draper Daniels. And yeah, I mean, I love this image of him because it shows, you know, the creative director role, this person that's super attractive, really well-dressed. He's having a drink in the middle of the day in his corner office as he's coming up with all the genius ideas, right? But let me tell you, that's not what the day-to-day job is like. I mean, I have had some late nights, you know, with drinks in a meeting room brainstorming, but that is not what happens every day. But, you know, it's a fun portrayal of what the role can be like. And then next to him, we have Jenna Lyons, who's, you know, a woman who dresses all of America. She's a fashion designer, and she used to be a creative director and president of J. Crew until she left in 2017. You know, you can see her. She's often, if you Google her, you can find tons of images of her in her office looking effortlessly chic. You know, the New York Times referred to her style as like geek, chic quirkiness. And, you know, I love it with her thick rimmed glasses. In a lot of them, she has this red lipstick and like her hair pulled back. And she's just sitting in this really cool large room plastered with all these inspirational images and materials and books. And, you know, it's funny because yes, a lot of the work and of the job is kind of like coming up with ideas and that inspiration and research, you know, but the reality is like, we rarely have private offices. I mean, now some of us are still working from home. We only spend a portion of our time doing this. Whereas like when you see all these pictures, it looks like that's all you do all the time, but really probably like 70% of their time, you're spending your time in meetings, having budget conversations, you know, doing interviews. There's like performance reviews, more meetings, right? So it's like, it's not all the work is creative as this image makes it look like, but you know, it's still a little part of it. So it's nice to see. And then finally, this guy on the right, you know, he's Jeff Cruz, he's chief creative officer at MRM McCann. And he used to be a CD at VSA and Leo Burnett. I chose him mostly because I really like this picture and it actually portrays a lot of like, there's a whole slew of CDs and ECDs that are photographed with their arms crossed, right? And I find that really interesting because it's like this very iconic power pose, right? And it reinforces this like mythology behind kind of like the lone creative genius, right? Like this lone creative director coming up with all the ideas on his own. When the reality is that creative directors are only as strong as their team. And like, we can't really do it alone. But if you look online, you can see a bunch of creative directors with these headshots, with this power pose. You know, there's even a Tumblr that's dedicated to it. One of my CDs pointed it to me like earlier in this year, I had never seen it. And it's called like ECDs with folded arms. And it's just like a really funny, you know, thing to see. But the truth is, a lot of CDs are just regular people like myself, right? Like people you've never heard of. We don't spend our time drinking in the middle of the day while ideating. We don't have private cool offices, and we definitely don't do it all by ourselves. So next we're going to talk about like the different types of creative directors, right? Like we've covered what the perception of a creative director can be, but now I want to show you a little bit of the different types of creative directors out there, you know, since they're different depending on the different industries. So I know some of you already mentioned Virgin Abloh, right? So let's start with fashion. He unfortunately died too young last year, and he's such an incredible talent. He was an architect turned fashion designer. He was the artistic director of Louis Vuitton menswear, and he was the CEO of Off-White. He's also named one of Time Magazine's 100 most influential people in the world in 2018. And for me, you know, being an experiential creative director, I especially appreciate the vision, not only behind his fashion, but like his fashion shows. I feel like they're so incredible. And, you know, you can truly see kind of like the influence of his architectural background by the shows that they would put up. And then next to him, we have Grace Coddington, also from the fashion world. She used to be the creative director at large of American Vogue until she left in 2016. And I really like this quote from The Guardian that says that she has produced some of fashion's most memorable imagery. Her pictures might be jolly and decadent or moody and mysterious. I learned about her when I watched the September issue film. If you haven't watched it, it's really good. And I just love her work and the way that she looks. I feel like we could be friends. And then the next two are an interesting category of creative director. It's the whole celebrity as creative director category, right? Which is, I would say, relatively newish, but Rihanna and Cardi B both fall into it. You know, they became creative directors for brands. In Rihanna's case, she became for Puma. And then for Cardi B, she did it for Playboy. And it's an interesting thing because instead of being spokespersons or ambassadors, they're now given the title of creative director. And, you know, they do get to influence the product and the collections. But, you know, there's like some discussion out there where some people think it's a vanity title, but I don't know. I think at the end of the day, you have to look at the situations on a case-by-case basis because some of the celebrities might be really involved and might actually be providing creative direction, but others might not. So I just think it's like an interesting category. And then finally, the last two are more traditional ad agencies and brands. So in the middle, we have Colleen DeCourcy, who retired last year from Wine & Kennedy. She was the global chief creative officer and president for nearly a decade. And then next to her, I put Alex Boneman, the global ECD at Spotify. And for him, I just wanted to share an example of, you know, CDs at brands. Because if you think about it, there's creative directors in almost every industry, right? Like if you look at Airbnb or Goldman Sachs or HBO, I mean, even in industries that you might not think of as a creative industry, they usually have creative directors on payroll. And I think that's probably what, you know, makes the definition so elusive in terms of creative directors. But at the same time, it's also good because it means there's many different ways to become a creative director. It means that there are lots of opportunities out there, you know, and for me, myself, like I mentioned earlier, I'm an experiential creative director, and that's a relatively new term as well. So I'll tell you a little bit in this next slide about what that means. So like I said, experiential, experiential creative director is a relatively new role, you know, and it has become more defined as experiential marketing as an industry has become a core of any advertising and marketing strategy for brands. You know, I started in events, and that eventually kind of morphed into experiential. And so I feel like it's been maybe in the last maybe 8 years that it's become a thing, and that brands are really saving money to invest in experiential and all these experiences. But what does that really mean when I say experiential? It means I create experiences for brands and determine how they're going to show up in the physical or virtual world, right? It's how are they going to interact with consumers, how the brand comes to life. And it's everything from, you know, concept to final experience, and all the ways that the experience might amplify, whether it's like the videos or on social media, all those things. So here on this slide, I have some pictures of me at work. You know, these are some of the experiences I've created, and, you know, some of the best things about the work that I do is getting to see the work come to life, you know, getting to walk inside it, walk around it, touch it, smell it. You know, it's instant gratification, and especially in an industry that's so intense, you know, there's a lot of late hours, it's a lot of work. It's always really nice to be able to see your work come to life, and you almost forget like all the pain and suffering, you know, once you see it up there. And, you know, if there's a performer or celebrities, like, it's just like a really great experience to have. And then you're able to go back and do it all over again. But again, like, experiential is interesting because it covers a lot of things. You know, it's everything from concepting to like the branding, right, to the marketing materials, whether it's like the website or an invitation that we have to design. But then it's also the physical, right? So it's what is the flow of the space? What are the floor plans? Like, what is the set design or the architecture that you're going to build if you get an empty warehouse and transform it? But you also have to be thinking about like, what are the activities and interactions that we want guests to have? What else is happening in the space? As well as, you know, what food are we serving? What drinks are being served? Do you brand your drinks so that they match with the brand or the experience? Do you create custom napkins? All that stuff. And then as well as like the music that's played, the content that's viewed, the things that are given away, all the things that we're going to share on social, and what that experience is, if it's social or virtual. We have to think about all of those things, which means you have to collaborate with a ton of people, right? It's a lot of different players, a lot of different disciplines, you know, like the tent people, the catering, the technology, all those people kind of working together. And as a creative director, you have to be that North Star, right? You're the one talking with a client that has like that creative vision, and you need to make sure that that's distilled down to everyone, and everyone understands your vision and is able to support it. And what's cool about that is if you're able to do a good job, it means all these different players understand your vision. They can go away, interpret it. And in many cases, you know, they come back with things or ideas that you couldn't even dream up yourself, right? So I remember having a catering partner, and they were incredible. And you would show them your mood boards and your vision, and then they would create like catering experiences that are more than just like a tray of food, but it could be like a cloud carrying the food. You know, it's things that actually add to the experience, and it's not just like its own isolated thing. But to do that, you need to trust your vendors and empower them and be clear with your vision so they can go and like do the thing that they're experts in and come back with something incredible. So like I said, when it comes together, there's no better feeling. At the same time, because it's so many different things that you're coordinating, there is a lot of like possibilities for errors and drama. But that's why, like, when we go to the skills that I'll talk about later on, those are some things that are very important. So I'm going to show you a video of an example of one of the larger, more complex projects I've worked on. I did it while I was working at Giant Spoon, and it's a project for HBO Game of Thrones that we did at South by Southwest. Oh, I don't think we can hear it.
There's no sound for some reason.
There's, imagine, really dramatic music.
I'm asking Kyle to unmute, and hopefully we can hear it through her speakers. Oh, perfect. Thank you, Kyle.
Thank you. Hope my dramatic music statement matched the music that was there. Anyway, so like I said, we did this at South by Southwest maybe 3 years ago, and we literally asked guests to bleed for the throne with on-site blood donations with the Red Cross. And again, for this project, we did everything from like the concept to the website to the set design, right? This was an empty warehouse that we then transformed to the Red Keep. And then we had a garden where we brought like all these tents from like a, that looked like a war camp. We got them custom made, and then we had to like rub dirt to make them look dirty. And then we also designed some of the costumes, you know, like the lady with a red dress, but then we also flew some of the costumes from the actual show. We created the pin that we gave away to guests who bled for the throne, you know, in recognition for their heroism. We designed a self-guided interactive technology experience that used projection mapping, pre-recorded theatrical content, motion sensors, you know, all this stuff to allow guests to walk in the footsteps of those characters who bled for the throne. We created the unique musical composition. We even altered the smell of the space. You know, we burned Palo Santo and incense to give it kind of like the right vibe. And then we got in trouble with the fire marshal for doing it, but whatever, it was worth it. But it was a beast. It was so much work, but it was also so much fun. It was probably one of the funnest projects I've ever worked in, you know, and it also helps that I love the brand. I love HBO and I'm a fan of Game of Thrones. So, you know, that's always a good thing. If you look for a job where you can work with clients that you have passion for, you know, that will just make the whole experience not necessarily easier, but like funner and rewarding, you know. In this case, because we were actually helping a cause, there was a blood shortage and we were actually getting blood for the Red Cross, there was that extra layer of like, this is not just a party. There's like something meaningful behind that, which is also really incredible. So we can move on from here. I know we've touched on what a creative director is and like the different types. And we've talked a little bit about what my specific path or as an experiential creative director, what that role is. And, you know, if you're still curious and interested about becoming a creative director, then this next part will go through what is the path to get there. And we'll talk a little bit about, you know, the traditional path. And then I'll give some examples, real life examples. So if we go to the next one, there's essentially three different paths. Oops, I don't know if people can see, it's really tiny. But you know, the three main paths are like the copywriting path, the art director path, or the designer path, right? And like they all kind of line up, and you know, they move sideways as you get promoted. But essentially, you can either start as an intern or like a junior. Some companies use junior, some companies use associate titles, but that's where you start. And then as you progress, you start losing the junior title, and then you become either a copywriter, art director, or designer, and then you earn the senior title, right? And then after that, the next step is you either become an associate creative director or an associate design director. And then from there is when you become the creative director or the design director. And then you can continue progressing through senior, group to executive. And then, you know, if you're lucky, because like there's not that many chief creator roles as there are like creative director roles, you can become that. But there's also, right, like you don't have to take the straight path. Like there's people who are designers who become art directors and then are creative directors, or design directors that then become creative directors, right? So there's like different paths and they can cross, but this is kind of like the standard version of it. And, you know, I think it's important that people remember that it changes depending on the company, it changes depending on the industry. A lot of people might think that like the creative director is like that final goal that you have to aim for. But I think it's important to keep in mind that it's not the only way to find success, right? I think some people love the design work and want to stay focused on the craft. And so for those people, they should just stay in the design path. And, you know, maybe they become a design director or an executive design director, and that might be a better route. There's also cases where an art director or a copywriter might not really want to deal with all the extra responsibility and management that comes with becoming a creative director. So some people might want to stay there. You know, I've known people that after being executive creative directors, you know, they go back to either becoming art directors or copywriters because they miss being in the work and doing the work. And they're more interested in doing that than guiding it. So again, like it's everyone's life. It's your own experience. Like you don't have to be a CD because you think that's like the top, like there's other ways to do things. And, you know, the path is really unique to yourself. And I think you have to keep true to yourself. You have to keep checking in with yourself along the way. Am I happy? Am I enjoying this? You know, you don't have to blindly pursue a path because you might end up at the top and realize it's not what you wanted. But the good news is, even if that happens, you can always go back. You can always change paths. You can always change careers. You can start your own ceramics business or start making beef jerky, whatever. Just like keep checking in with yourself because that's important. So next, I started doing this exercise where I looked at creative directors I've worked with or people I've worked with and looked at their paths to compare, you know, depending on our different kind of like starts where we all landed. So I have three people here. I removed their names to protect them because I didn't ask permission. But essentially, there are these real world examples, you know, and we all started in kind of like the same, you know, Bachelor of Arts, but very different starts. You can see there, the first person started with sociology and religion, the second person film studies and English, and then I'm the last one. I went to school for industrial design, and then you can see how it progresses. So the person in green, she went from school to promotions assistant to experiential marketing manager to a project coordinator to director of production. So she actually was on a production path. And then there you can see the switch. She became creative director and then an executive creative director. And now she's a chief creative officer at a experiential agency in New York. And I remember when she shifted to creative director, again, like nobody, I did not know what the path was. I did not know anything about it. And I was like, wait, what? Like the producer became a creative director? I was so confused. But then when I think back, you know, when we worked together and she was just a project coordinator, like she was so creative and like we would go to installs and like she would be hands-on and helping us style and helping us come up with stuff. Like she was not staying in her lane. Some people don't like that. I don't have a problem as long as your contributions are awesome. She was amazing. And, you know, now she's there. She's a chief creative officer. So awesome. And then the next person, he is on a writing path, right? So he comes from a copy background. So he started, like I said, as a film studies in English, then he did an MFA in dramatic writing, then he became an adjunct professor writing for TV, and then he switched to a creative agency where he was a creative, then he was a screenwriter, then a creative director, that's where we worked together, then he became group creative director, and now he's an ECD at an ad agency in New York, and then finally my path, which is probably the most straightforward in terms of what I shared before. Like I said, I had a BA in industrial design and I didn't want to work, you know, designing cell phones or one product for the rest of my life. I always knew I was interested in like a multidisciplinary agency. And so I started a job in New York City at an events company where I was a junior designer and I was promoted fairly quickly, you know, from junior designer to senior designer. And then I sat at the design director role for about 6 years. You know, all those roles happen within the same company. I was there for like 10 and a half years, which is, I think, not very usual these days, but I loved my job. And so I stayed there for a long time. And then, you know, I got to the point where I had been in the same role for 6 years. I'm ready for the next thing. The next thing is creative director, and the creative director is the owner of the company, right? So there's like nowhere else for me to go. So I quit that job. And then I went to LinkedIn and I gave myself the promotion I deserved. You know, I knew I was ready. So I just changed my title, became a creative director, and started doing freelance creative direction work. And then after that, I was offered a full-time role at a different company. That's actually where I met Lissy from Creatively. And I was there for a while. Then I switched over to become an experiential creative director at Giant Spoon. And now, like I said, I'm an ECD at Jack Morton. So again, like it's a little bit more straightforward, but I just wanted to share some of that with you. And also I want to mention, you know, these three people, we all happen to have a Bachelor of Arts, but that doesn't have to be the case, right? I also taught a class earlier this year or last year, I can't remember, for a program called DNAD, New Blood Shift. And it's essentially a partnership between DNAD, Google, and Adidas, and it's a free industry-led night school program for emerging creatives who don't have a college degree. And, you know, the class that I taught, the people in it were incredibly talented and they had all sorts of backgrounds. There was like a guy who was a hat maker and people just with all these different skills. Yeah, I can link the program. There are actually, I think I read earlier today, if they're starting their search for new people, I think later in the in May, I think. So you can look it up. But it's a great program. If you can join, you should do it. But, and I'm sure there's other things like that. That just happens to be the one I know about. But also, you know, internships are a good way to start if you don't have the training. You know, I think most companies now pay for internships, and I think people are becoming a little bit more open to I know at least at Jack Morton, we're really good about like not looking at like the education, because again, if we want to be, you know, diverse and inclusive, you can't be doing that because then you're curating from the same pool of people. So I think companies are doing a better job of more looking at the work, the portfolios. You know, if you don't have a portfolio, like enter competitions and make your own work. There's a lot of ways to go about it in a creative way. But at the end of the day, I think most people look at the portfolio. So if you don't have work, make it up and just make it look good. Cool. And then lastly, we're going to look at like what makes a good creative director. So if we skip to the next slide, like I said, we've already talked about the path and how you might get there and all the different ways that you can get there. So next we'll talk about the skills and qualities that, in my opinion, make a good creative director. So the first one is curiosity. And I would say of anything, this is probably the best thing to have. It has served me really well. You know, as you could see when in my intro slide, I have various interests, you know, in art, in gardening, in perfumery, ceramics, camping, traveling. I love Broadway. I love dance, you know, and all of these things have informed my work. You know, for some of them, I've taken classes. I took a perfumery class because I wanted to create my own perfume. And then I learned it's like way harder than you can imagine. But still, I love it. And, you know, I think that informs my, you know, introducing scents into events, because that takes you back, right? And the connection between like the brain and scent is so important. So things like that are just interesting to do, you know, and some of them are activities that I follow or things that I pursue. But again, like the more things that you feed your brain, they're going to eventually inform your work, right? Just put more stuff, and eventually you'll just like somehow you'll be like, oh, remember that thing? You'll be able to access it. Because if you think about it, a lot of the creative work is about not only connecting dots, but finding a unique way to connect the dots, right? And in my mind, the more dots you have, the more connections you're going to be able to make, right? So again, I encourage you to broaden your world, stay curious, read. That's a sculpture that I made when I was at David Stark, for Target. And it was a program called Read Across America, and it was all made out of books, but I figured it was a good image for this slide. And the next, communication, is another big part of creative direction. And like, when I say communication, there's like so many ways communication is important. Because as a creative director, what you say and how you say it is extremely important, right? Because you can have incredible ideas, the best ideas, but if you are not able to clearly and convincingly like explain them and sell them, then it doesn't matter. So telling a good story is really important. You know, it's going to help you sell your ideas, you know, whether it's internally with your team or externally with your clients, right? Because being a creative director doesn't mean you can just do whatever you want. you still need to get buy-in from like the different stakeholders internally and externally, right? And sometimes you need to adjust what you're emphasizing depending on who you're speaking to. So it's all about kind of like knowing your audience. So for example, if I need to convince production that this idea is great versus a client, I will take two different approaches, right? And this is where being a creative director means kind of like understanding the different stakeholders, what they need to hear, and not just focusing on one aspect of the project, but like seeing the whole picture. There's also a matter of protecting the integrity of the work, which is a big part of the creative director's role, right? It's like not allowing your ideas to get watered down or chopped up, because clients love to do that. They're like, we like this idea, and this idea. And it's like, no, they're meant to be different ideas, right? So you need to protect them. And, you know, the best ideas are usually new ideas that are out of people's comfort zones that might have never been done before. And so you really need to be able to communicate where the value is and give people the tools to do the same for their bosses. Because in many cases, as a creative director, you might not be able to present to the ultimate decision makers. And so you need to be able to give your clients the tools to go and like sell their work. Oh my God, my cat is jumping. Okay. And then there's also communicating in a more practical way, right? Like with clients, you know, and sometimes it means getting to the root of what they really want. It might require some detective work. You know, sometimes you need to like, a client says that they want something, but that's not what they really want. They want something else, but they just don't know how to communicate it. So you might have to dig and pry to get to the roots of things. You know, you have to ask the right questions. So again, communication is super important. And then also there's the communication with your team, which is also crucial, right? It's like when you're providing feedback, when you're giving constructive criticism, right? Like if you have to tell a designer, you know, that the work is not right and you have to start from scratch and throw it all away, like you need to be able to communicate that in a diplomatic way that will be constructive, right? You don't want to crush their soul and like demotivate them. You want to give them an understanding of why what they did doesn't work and how to get it right in the next round, right? And then also sometimes, many times, I think this is probably one of the hardest things for creative directors is to like temper this desire to try and like do it yourself, right? Because like you've done it, you've come through the path, you know what you want, I know how to do it, it will just be faster, I'll do it better, whatever, right? And but as a creative director, like even though it might feel easier to do that, to do it yourself rather than try to explain it to someone else, you can't really fall into that trap, because as tempting as it may be, right, it's not going to be good in the long term. Like you can't be the person doing it. If that's what you want to do, again, go back to art director or copywriter. Don't be a CD, because that's not the job, and you need to empower the people and let them do their job and just give them enough feedback so that if they're not getting it right, they can understand how to get there. So again, super important. The stronger your communication skills, the better results you will get, which leads me to the last point that I think is really important, which is leadership. And that image, I forgot to mention why I put that image. That's me explaining people how to assemble a centerpiece, you know, out of 400 centerpieces. So again, communication is important there. But lastly, leadership. Like I said before, the creative director, you're the North Star, right? You're guiding all these different teams to the same point. And I put this picture in here because even though I'm in the throne, I am not alone, right? In this project, that's the one I showed you the video. You know, that project was only possible thanks to every single person in this picture and the many more that are not in the picture. All the different vendors, the people that didn't, you know, were working in the office and didn't make it on site. It's just like proof that like you can achieve so much more and bigger things when you can guide others. So I love this image. it's also the real throne. So that was really cool. And then you need to create the right environment for the team to thrive. Again, like super important. Like it's all about the team. If you don't have a good team, you're not going to succeed. And so you also have to make sure that the environment is good. And I personally think it means, you know, leading, not leading with fear. You want people to feel safe so that when they make mistakes, they're able to learn from them. You want to encourage collaboration because the best ideas come from anywhere. I've had situations where a producer or an account director have been the ones to inspire the big ideas. And I really like that. I want to encourage that. I want to make sure everyone feels comfortable to be creative. And, you know, at the end of the day, it's a hard job. It takes many long hours. So you should make it fun, right? For yourself and for others, because it is a fun job. I mean, I love my job most of the time, at least. That's it. We covered a lot. I know we're almost out of time. I didn't realize it was going to take so long. I honestly thought it was going to be 30 minutes. But we got through a lot of in a short time. So if there's things I didn't cover, if you want some questions, we can go through them.
Yeah, thanks, Juliana. Thank you guys as well for joining. So now we're going to get into our Q&A part. For those who didn't know, I was like frantically waving a few times, just being like, hey, but I'm Lizzie from Creatively, and I'm the head of creator and experiential marketing. And as Juliana mentioned, we met each other way back in a past life at a former agency where she was creative director and I was doing creative strategy and account work. So it's so great to have her here and have this full circle moment because she is just so incredible. So thank you for your time, Juliana. I'm happy to read aloud a couple questions that we've received. So I'm going to go ahead and pick a few. Thank you as well for everyone with the really thoughtful questions. This first question is from Glenn, and they asked, are experiential agencies open to hire creative directors that don't have a ton of experiential specific work in their book?
Yes. You know, especially now the market is really aggressive in terms of finding creatives. So I think companies are becoming more open-minded. Of course, it's easier if you can see the work, but for me, it's more about the thinking, right? So especially if you're a creative director, because I think, you know, it would be harder to hire an art director when what you really need is a, I don't know, a 3D designer. Like those skills are not so transferable. But I think right now, you know, there's a lot of people from ad agencies working in experiential companies.
Thanks, Juliana. Another question for you is, what is the best way to showcase our creative abilities when we have not served the design sector, but definitely other creative fields?
You mean like copywriters and stuff like that?
Or yeah, Christina, do you mind dropping in the chat if you want to explain? Just want to make sure we best answer your question. If you want to elaborate, we're happy to answer. But while I wait for Christina to provide, she says for art and artists.
I mean, again, in specifically in experiential, there's like a lot of room for all these different skills. Like, you know, I've hired, I mean, graphic designers that I've trained to become experiential designers and like taught them how to do the 3D work and all that stuff. You know, when I hired them, that was a long time ago. It was more like I gave them a project. I gave them a project, and it's the thinking that came back that helped, right? So like in that scenario, it was easy because like the project was able to showcase, even if somebody didn't have the work in their portfolio, it helped kind of like convey the thinking behind it. But, you know, I would recommend you go into like different kind of creative websites, you know, like maybe creatively you can see how people showcase their work. Maybe you can go to, you know, other places where creatives show their work and see how, you know, there's nothing better than when I look at a creative director that's a copywriter and their website is beautiful. Then I'm like, okay, this person is not only a good writer, but he has a good eye, or she has a good eye, right? And you can tell that even though you know, and just hire people. If you can't do it, then hire somebody else to make the website look incredible.
Thank you, Juliana. A couple other questions you received is from Danielle, and she asked, what personality traits does a successful creative director need?
I mean, I feel like you have to be able have a tough skin, right? I don't know if that's a personality trait, but right, in many cases, it's like, if clients don't like your ideas, people don't like your ideas, you have to be able to like move on and let things roll. I mean, you should fight for them, but at some point, like if it's not selling, like just move on. I think, I don't know. I mean, there's different approaches in terms of personality. I like nice people. I only want to work with nice people. So I think, you know, someone that's nice, someone that's empathetic and can like see different points of view. Yeah. Resiliency. Yeah. And grit. Totally. All those things.
What do you think? This is an interesting question. It's from Kat, which is funny because I know your cat has made some celebrity appearances today. But what is your best advice for someone who has been trucking along in the design industry, striving to get to ACD? She says she's been at it for 12 years and just currently got to senior AD. She sees very young designers getting brought on and are immediately catapulted to ACD or CD, sometimes without proper training or steps. It's not that they're not talented, they just aren't fully there. Any advice?
Listen, I feel like in situations like that, there can be different things happening. Like maybe you're not ready, right? Like maybe you're missing certain things. And I think important to ask your managers, like, what are concrete steps, things that I need to do in order to get there? Sometimes it's more about like, you've been in a company for too long and they can't see you as something else, right? Like maybe it's no fault of your own, but I've just been here for 10 years and they still see me as a junior designer when I know that I'm ready for something else. And sometimes you just need to like take a leap and move somewhere else. But I think in many cases, like it might be, there's like certain things that you're not doing, right? Like, are you raising your hand and volunteering, right? Like if you see, you know, when I think of like my young creatives that are like very successful, these are people that are, and it might be some of the people that you're saying like get promoted really easily. These are people that like, if I need something, they raise their hand. If like there's another project or another team that needs help, they're there to help, right? So it gives you more visibility to different people making decisions. It gives you more opportunities to try different work. Again, like I don't know the specifics of your situation, but I think one of those things or a combination of them could be the case.
Juliana, we have just a couple more. A question from Andrea, which is kind of actually related to the last question in terms of like the indirect path sometimes to being a CD. She asked, how can we become a CD if we work for ourselves freelancing? It seems like every path was routed in getting a job and working your way up. So I think they're trying to figure out how to still get on that path, even if they have worked for.
I mean, if you're freelancing in the industry, it should be easy or should be possible, right? Like I mentioned, like I promoted myself to creative director and started doing it freelance. And once I did enough work, then I was able to, I mean, actually it happened pretty quickly, but I was able to change to a full-time job. So, you know, I don't know if that's specific of your question, but I think whether freelance or full-time, you know, like my partner, he's like a permanent full-time creative director, but he's a freelancer, right? Like he's worked with me, he's worked with other people, and he has had full-time jobs as well, but like he's still been able to continue in the path on a freelance way, if that makes sense.
That makes a lot of sense. Thanks, Juliana. In addition, we'll do two more. One is from Scott Maddie. They asked, can you explain the difference between creative directors and design directors in terms of their duties?
Yeah, so I think design directors are more focused on the craft of design, right? I feel like that's the basic. It's like, it's the craft of design versus like a creative director might have to think about like a lot of other things, you know, a bigger picture, all these different vendors or, you know, skills, careers coming together. I think in the design, you're able to stay more focused specifically on the design, and creative direction is a little bit more about like, is the copyright, is the tone right? Are we, you know, meeting all these other things? So again, like creative directors and design directors need to work closely together. But yeah, you know, sometimes I think about if I had known that I could have been an executive design director, if I would have stayed in that path, if that existed, or if I had known it existed, and maybe I would have, because I loved being a design director, but I also love being a creative director. So
thanks, Liana. We'll get to the last question. Sorry, guys, I know we're out of time. So please feel free to reach out to Juliana either on Creatively or via Instagram, which we'll put up her handle in just a second. The last question is from Bridget, and they asked, what would you recommend for people just starting off in the industry? And in this case, I'm going to interpret industry as like someone who's just starting off in like a marketing creative field or agency side.
I mean, and they don't have a job, right? Is it about getting a job or like if
you have a job? I think it sounds like someone who's just starting out. So maybe a recent graduate or someone who doesn't have a lot of years.
Yeah, I mean, if you don't have a job, apply everywhere. I remember for my first job, I applied everywhere. I called them, I had a script, you know, and I needed to get a green card. So there was like an extra layer of complication because I needed to get sponsored. So you have to like sell yourself. You know, and in my scenario, like they gave me a project, which, you know, some people are very anti-project. I think it depends on what level in your career is, right? Like if you're junior or right out of college, I think that's fair because you might not have done the job, especially when I was doing it, like people didn't go to school for events. So it was really hard to see that. So they would give you a project to showcase your thinking. And then they're like, okay, cool. This person is really creative and the solutions are great. So I would do that. You know, there's all these other programs like the one I shared, or if there's like internships to get in, you know, usually if you're able to get into a company, no matter the route and you're good, they will hold on to you. That's kind of been my experience. You know, I've hired a ton of interns. So yeah, that's what I would say about that.
Thanks, Juliana. Any like last parting words before we say goodbye to everyone?
No, I mean, this was really fun, even though it was me talking to a void, but I felt all your chats, even though I couldn't read them all because I can't multitask like that. But I appreciate you all being here and I hope it was helpful. And thank you Creatively for having me.
Thank you so much for joining us, Liana, both professionally and personally. Thank you. I'm going to go ahead and put up the hold screen so you guys can get her Instagram, and she can catch up on the chats. But thank you guys all for your time, and we can't wait to see what you create. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks. Bye.